Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. My name is Marcus Grodi, your host for this program. If you happen to have noticed on the internet the projected guest for tonight's program, you might see that the guest is different tonight. We had a little bit of a change today because the scheduled guest's plane was canceled, and so they couldn't get down here from Canada. So we'll reschedule him for another program. But it so happened that we have another guest tonight who happened to be here at EWTN for another reason. Sister Teresa Benedicta Black is a Dominican sister, and she'll join us tonight for the program. And she's not here to talk about her own journey, but the journey of her parents that eventually culminated in her journey. And we'll talk about that tonight. But remember, you're an important part of the program, so let me begin by giving the phone numbers so you can start calling us with your questions or emails. 1-800-221-9460. If you're outside North America, you can call at 205-271-2980, or you can send an email at journeyhome@ewtn.com. Welcome, sister, to the Journey Home program. Now, tell the audience why you were here at EWTN, available for the program.
Actually, the sisters all came down to do a catechetical program for young people, kindergarten through fifth grade, to teach the faith. So we were here doing the program, teaching the faith, and I found out this morning that God had other plans as well.
Well, that's the way God works, you know, all the time. He likes to keep us ready, you know, able at any time to give a reason for the hope that is in us, right? That's what it said in 1 Peter. Well, this is your time, and it's great to have you on the program. But I also mentioned to the audience that I'm quite sure, as you tell your story, that you're going to be able to tell them why I've heard about your family for a while and have been encouraged to have you or your parents on the program before by someone that's very familiar to the audience. But I'll leave that to you. So I'll let you begin by giving us some of the spiritual foundation of your parents.
All right. Well, I think I'll begin with my mom's background. My mom's family were self-described humanists. They believed in man for the sake of man. And so she grew up being taught that you did good things for the sake of humanity, and that the sciences, the art, literature, all of that was the most important part of human civilization. And her dad was a self-described atheist, and he read all the modern philosophers, Rousseau, Descartes, Voltaire, etc. And from a very early age, he encouraged my mom to be reading these philosophers. And my mom said, you know, she read them probably by the time she was 13 or 14. She had read all these modern philosophers
without really
being able to grasp all the intricate details of what they were saying, but getting their end point that God really didn't exist and truth was relative. And so as a young child, my mom very quickly, when she hit her teenage years, and you know, teenage was a tumultuous time in your life, and there are tons of things going on, and it was just a very difficult point, and she began to think, well, if truth is relative, and there is no God, what's the point of even living? And very quickly on, my mom became extremely depressed, and she actually went out and bought the pills and thought, I'm just gonna commit suicide, because there is no truth, there's no point in life, and why should I bother suffering if there's no purpose to suffering? And she describes, as a fairly young teen, one night having the pills on in front of her, determined to kill herself, and just suddenly sensing this presence in the room and realizing that she didn't know everything and thinking, you know, if I'm right and truth is relative, if all these philosophers that I've read are telling me the truth, then I can kill myself anytime. It doesn't matter when I kill myself, you know, if there's no God. But if I'm wrong, if in that one little window of area that I don't know about, God exists, then how can I possibly kill myself because of that one chance?
Yeah, yeah.
And so she decided to put off committing suicide on the hope of that one chance. But through most of her teenage years, she was extremely depressed and kept waiting for that one chance to make its appearance. And she said when she was 18, she was culturally Presbyterianism because they had a great choir. And that was the sole reason they went to church, was so she could sing in the choir.
Again, and arts and music.
Art, music, literature, et cetera. And she was a puppeteer, actually. She was very involved in the artistic element of the church as well. And the pastor there came to her and asked her to become an ordained minister in the Presbyterian church. And my mom turned to him and said, you know, I don't even know if I believe in God. And the pastor said, "That's okay. I don't know if I believe in him either." So my mom
now
became...
Let me say, that's not true of all Presbyterians. I happen to have once been a Presbyterian pastor. But sadly, there are. Sadly, there was a famous Englishman 300 years ago that made a statement in a book, Richard Baxter. He said, "It's a sin when a man becomes a pastor before he's a Christian." Mm-hmm. And it's interesting, in this case, he's encouraging your mother when neither of them may even believe in the reality of God. Very sad, but interesting.
Yes.
Point to her journey. Go ahead.
And so my mom, she let him convince her to actually become the youngest ordained minister in the United States for the church at that time. I don't know if it's changed since then. But they had to take an oath become an ordained minister, and part of the oath was belief in God. And my mom said, "I'm not going to promise that because I don't believe in him." And the pastor said, "Well, we can just change the rite, and the rite will say that you believe in truth and you're willing to seek truth." And so my mom agreed to be ordained under those conditions, and she took the ordination, and she knew it was kind of a farce for her to take it, but she said it made a big difference because she realized she had made an oath that she would at least seek for truth. And so there she
did
was.
Did she go to seminary?
I don't think so. I think it was just his. Just his.
Wow.
His choice.
Very interesting.
So, so she took this oath and knew she had to do something, but at the same time was extremely depressed, extremely discouraged. Didn't want to go to college. Thought there was no point. There is no truth. Why bother continuing on in life? And pretty much on her mother's forcing her, and because she had a scholarship, she decided to go to Hunter College and study philosophy. And then to go back to my dad at this point, my dad was Jewish, and he was raised in a fairly strict Jewish home. Was conservative, but his grandfather was Orthodox, and the grandfather played an extremely important role in his life. And the grandfather would daily walk to shul, and he would often follow his grandpa into the services. And he said when the services went on, there was a point where it got really long and the kids would leave. And there was a highway billboard on the side outside the synagogue, and he would often climb up the highway billboard to the top, and he would often talk to God on top of the billboard because he felt just he was really close. And for my dad, in the Jewish tradition, there's not a lot of emphasis on a personal relationship with God. It's very different than what you'd find like in the Protestant or Catholic Church. But from a very young age, because he would go up on the billboard, he developed this idea of God being very close and someone you could talk to. And he said he would often sit up there and just question God about the Old Testament and all the problems that he saw and and asking God, what does it mean, and trying to figure it out. As he got older and hit his teenage years, of course, it was the time of the hippies, and he joined and had hair down to his knees and hitchhiked across the United States at age 16. And then went on and went to Stanford College, actually again at age 16, starting off in a career in journalism, and ended up switching over to music. And his college years were a time where he pretty much fell away from the faith and lived a very sinful life, the burdens of which he, still to this day will talk about as weighing on him. And then after his college years, he ended up feeling, again, just real devastated and lonesome, and decided that it was time for him to go back to his faith, that his childhood of traveling with his grandfather to shul. And so he ended that year kind of with a very simple prayer to God of asking forgiveness and wanting to come back to him.
All right. Now, is he still out in California at this point?
Yes.
Okay. So your mother's in going to Hunter College.
And he's in California. And they actually, kind of back up, they had met each other in high school. My mom's maiden name was Baker and my dad was Block. So they ended up sitting next to each other all through high school. And they weren't boyfriend or girlfriend, but my dad had always admired my mother very much, and they often talked after school about art and literature and sciences. And so as my dad was starting to come back to his faith, he decided, just kind of on a whim, that he was going to start writing my mom, which was at the point that she was converting.
All right, okay. So he's in California writing her.
Yes.
Because he kind of remembers what, but it's interesting what was drawing him back to her was, of course, not the issues of the faith. It was.
No.
It was maybe just a yearning within his heart for someone, but also what he remembered of her, the humanities, the arts, and her interest in that. And of course, that's why she's at Hunter, right? She's she's an ordained Presbyterian minister who doesn't believe in God. She's going to Hunter to study philosophy. Very interesting. All right. Well, what is it then that, did it begin with your father or your mother?
It began with my mother, because at that point at Hunter College, Dietrich and Alice von Hildebrand were teaching philosophy. And my mother ended up
Did she go there because of them?
No, she never even heard of them.
Okay.
She went there because she had a full scholarship in there, and she thought, I might as well go where I don't have to pay any money, and I'm not wasting my parents' time or effort and financial resources. It's a cheap, free ride, and it'll make my mom happy.
All right.
And that was her sole reason for going there.
Okay.
And she ended up, her very first class was with Alice von Hildebrand in philosophy, and she had a great respect for Alice von Hildebrand because she was a woman and she was teaching philosophy. And my mom thought, you know, here's someone who's liberated, who's modern, a woman in the university's teaching. And her very first question is, what is truth? And my mom was so proud because, you know, since a little girl, she'd been reading Voltaire and Rousseau and Descartes, and she knew the answer. And so she gave this brilliant, brilliant exposition on how there was no truth and it was all relative. And she said as she talked, Alice's face just glowed and she got this bigger and bigger smile the more my mom talked. And when she finally finished, Alice von Hildebrand said, oh my dear, I am so glad you said that. I was hoping somebody would say that. And she spent the rest of the class tearing apart her answer, point by point by point. And my mom said that the rest of the semester, she would, you know, hurry home after college and get all her arguments together from the modern philosophers and take it back to the classroom. And Alice would go gently, calmly, and pull it apart point by point, revealing the truth to my mother. And eventually, my mom, seeing her example, and also I think she was greatly drawn by Alice and Dietrich von Hildebrand's relationship with each other.
Hmm.
And she said, like, when they were together, she always had the sense of just the holiness of their marriage and how much they loved each other. And their personal witness of that greatly drew my mom as well. And she began to realize they had something that she didn't have. And that was that window of opportunity, that area of unknown that she'd been searching for all her life.
Hmm.
And through their influence, she wanted to come home to the Catholic faith. So she asked both of them to be her sponsors and godparents into the faith. And she became Catholic, which is right at the point that my dad started to write her.
Okay, well, let's stop there for a second, because I'm wondering, consider this. In her study of philosophy under Dr. von Hildebrand, excuse me, at Hunter, I'm sure she has to be guarded,
yes,
to a certain extent on how she can talk about the faith. She's teaching philosophy, so she has to be guarded. So when she is ripping apart your mother's arguments, she's got to be a little guarded on what she can say and what she can't, I presume, at that point.
Yeah, and I think their arguments weren't so much about the Catholic faith versus the
right.
Presbyterian faith. It was simply on, is there a truth?
Yes.
And if there is truth, how do you discover it? And so it was more getting an understanding of the big picture. And that was enough for my mom to realize she has answers that I've never found elsewhere. And it was that really drew my mom to seeking, where is she getting her answers from? And it was in those private conversations later, I think, that she was able to fill in those gaps.
And I'm also, and that's good, because I mean, there's a lot there we could talk about, because it shows you that a study of good philosophy is not something that draws a person away from the faith to man-made inventions. It, in fact, draws people to the faith if it's study of good philosophy. Now, you can study bad philosophy, and that's where it ended up your mother off in the wrong direction originally. But there's also another question I had in this sense, in that here she is, an ordained Presbyterian minister that doesn't believe in God, right? I mean, that's right. And then she's pretty soon drawn to the Catholic Church through the study of philosophy. At some point in there, was there another point in which she had this aha reality of God? You know what I'm saying? Did she come to a belief in God before she entered the Catholic? I'm sure she did before she entered the Catholic.
Does
she talk
yes.
about that? Maybe she doesn't talk about that. But
I think it was more, I mean, yes, I think it was more gradual, though, as well.
Yeah.
It was realizing there is a truth. And if there is a truth, then there is a God. And so there was this kind of gradual acceptance of, okay, God exists in general, and then who is he? And so it was more, I don't know that there was any one moment of aha, as a gradual
thing. So we have this intellectual journey
yes.
to God. Was there an emotive side too, as she talks about looking back? I mean, where she starts to really sense the joy of discovering, or does come later after she became a Catholic?
You know, I'm not sure.
Okay, all right.
I don't know.
And sometimes, yeah, I'm a dad, and I don't know if I ever let my kids know, you know, all the details of my own journey. I know that. And, okay, so there she is, and she's being drawn because, in a certain sense, very intellectual, the reality of truth. And if there's truth, it's got to come from somewhere. I mean, there, so that opens up the reality of the designer and the God behind it all. And your dad's out there in California, right?
Yes.
This is the post-hippie stage, though, still for him. He's beyond that, but he's starting to write. Okay, why don't you pick up the story?
All right, so he's starting to write. And, of course, my mom's just converted. And in the
She has converted.
Yes, at that point. She had just come into the faith. And in that fervor of being a new convert, they would write. It's funny, my dad said they would have 2 to 3 times a week, they would write 6 to 7 8-page letters to each other. So, I mean, it was
before television?
No. Yeah, really. So it was huge, huge correspondence. And my mom, naturally being a new convert, frequently would talk about her love of the new faith. And so they began to exchange books back and forth with each other. And for my mom, you know, reading about the Jewish faith was not a big deal. But for my dad, to read Augustine's Confessions, or Thomas Merton, his Seven-Story Mountain, and to see these brilliant intellectual people who are able to enter into the faith made such an impact on him. And in addition to that, my mom began to ask him to read the Bible. And he'd never, ever read the Bible as a Jew. That was, you know, you just don't do that. And he had an idea of what it was about from, you know, the media, but that was his perspective, the media's analysis of the Bible. And so to read it for the first time was amazing to him. And he said as he read it, he suddenly realized all the holes in Judaic thought, all those questions he had as a little boy up on the billboard questioning God, they were being answered in the Bible. And so it was just amazing to my father as he read it and began to study it and think, there's something here. It's filling in what's missing in the Judaic thought that he'd studied all his life. But it's still, he wasn't quite ready to come in, and their relationship grew closer and closer, and he asked my mom to marry him, and so they decided to get married as a mixed marriage. And there were people who were against it from both sides. His family seriously considered disowning my father because he was marrying outside of the faith. And, you know, to this day, the Catholic faith is not something that's discussed among my Jewish relatives at all. And it's kind of, we don't talk about it. Like, I think they know he's converted since then, but it's never ever discussed. And it was an extremely painful moment for them when he decided to marry a woman who wasn't Jewish. And from my mom's perspective, of course, everyone was extremely concerned. Here she is, this, you know, newly made Catholic, marrying outside of the faith. And that wonderment, how is this going to work? And both my parents, both in some ways very naively, having this great willingness that it was going to work. And my dad would go with my mom to Mass, and my mom would go with my dad to shul, and they were determined that it was going to be a beautiful marriage, despite the fact that they were of different faiths. So that came through, and they just got married. And my mom would go with dad to synagogue, and dad would go with mom to the Mass. And it wasn't a big deal for my mom, but for my dad to go to the Mass was an amazing thing. And he said he suddenly realized that just as in the Jewish faith you had your faithful who attended the synagogue daily, the Catholics had their faithful who attended the Mass services daily. And just as the Jewish faith, you know, would pray the Psalms daily, the Catholics would pray the Psalms in the Divine Office. And many times he said the priests there would pray for the conversion of the Jews and would pray for the Jewish people. And it was an eye-opener for him to see that there really was a great love for the Jewish faith in the Catholic Church, and that there was so much in the Church that was to be admired and loved. And very quickly on, too, my mom got pregnant. And as he realized he was going to have a son, my father more and more began to think about, I'm responsible for another soul. And this child's going to be born into the family, and how am I going to raise him in two faiths? Because he began to realize that's not going to be possible. And what is it that I want my son to grow up learning and teaching? And so it became extremely important to him to find out what the truth was. And so privately, without telling my mom, he began to seek instruction about the Catholic faith. And again, it was kind of gradual for my dad, little by little, seeking the truth and understanding what the faith had to say. And my mom's version, which my dad laughs at, but it's true. He's a musician, so he was writing a mass for my mom in honor of the first son's birth. Wow. And he was in the middle of writing the credo when he suddenly realized, I believe this. And he went and told my mom, I'm going to become Catholic. And it was at my eldest brother Isaac's baptism that he actually went up to Dietrich or Alice von Hildebrand, who was there, and said, will you be my sponsor into the faith? I want to become Catholic. Mm. And she, of course, was overjoyed.
Yes. So are they living out in the East Coast? Did he?
Well, they were married on the East Coast, and we moved around a whole bunch as kids because music jobs are hard. And right now, they're out both in New Mexico, actually, and my dad's chair of the music department out there.
Of the university?
At the University of New Mexico, yes.
So he ended up focusing on, what's his angle of music?
It was music theory and composition, and he taught that for many years, and now he's more in that administration end of it.
All right, okay, all the way from the keyboard. And
All
right. Now, how did this then translate? Here you have convert parents, Jewish background, Presbyterian. I don't even know if you claim that. It's kind of a strange avenue there for your mother.
Yes.
But really more of a humanist, atheist. The conversion of faith, both of them fairly intellectual, but real, very intense. And you're an example of how it communicates. How did it talk about its communication down to you children? And then how that eventually helped you hear you discern your call to religious life?
Well, I think one of the important things to go on to say is that they had seven kids, and I'm the third child. And one of the things that very early on I think made such an impact in spreading the faith is my mom had always dreamed of homeschooling her kids. And this was back before homeschooling was ever done.
Yeah.
And nobody did it at that time. And she really didn't have religious reasons for doing it. She just thought it would be neat to be able to teach your kids at home and have that one-on-one impact. And so she ended up talking to my dad and saying, you know, could I just try it out with, you know, Isaac the eldest? And my dad laughed at the idea. He thought, you know, who homeschools their kids? You know, you want them to grow up to be educated and have a great intellectual background, and you're not going to do that at home. And so they argued back and forth about it, and finally they thought, well, who are the most educated people we know? And of course it was Alice von Hildebrand. And they said, well, let's call up her and see what she thinks. And if she says that's okay, then my dad agreed to let it go for a year as an experiment. And so my mom called up Alice von Hildebrand, and she said she was just so scared when she, you know, called her up and thought she's going to laugh at me for this foolish idea. And she asked her, you know, what do you think? Should I, you know, go ahead with this? And Alice said, I don't see how you could do anything else. So my mom decided to homeschool us. And it was so beautiful for us children because, you know, both my parents had the intellectual background to do that. And it also made it possible for the faith to become part of our everyday life because, you know, your parents are your primary teachers. And as part of being homeschooled, not only could my mom implement the daily feast days and set up, I mean, like we said, the rosary together in the afternoon and evening prayers. But it also meant my father, who wanted to pass on the Jewish faith, was able to ask that we learned Hebrew in school. So we were studying, you know, Hebrew as we grew up. And he also made sure that, again, as we celebrated the feast days, we'd celebrate Hanukkah and Passover. And it became a real realization of how the Jewish faith was the foundation of the Catholic faith. So it was implemented in both ways. And I think also as I grew older, you know, speaking of my parents' example and the witness to us, my father would always pray the Divine Office every single day because as a Jew, he prayed the Psalms. And so it was important for him to continue that. And as a teenager, he said, I want to teach you the most important prayer I know. And so he would pray with me every day. And to have that time, you know, with your dad as a young teenage girl, praying the Psalms daily had a great impact on me and my own vocation. And it's a large part why I chose the name Teresa Benedicta as a sister, because she's a convert from Judaism who was killed in Auschwitz.
Yes.
And I wanted to honor him and how much his faith has played out in our life.
That was the reason, that was the connection there with Edith Stein, right?
And, yes.
And when did you discern? At what point in your life did you?
Well, it's funny because my parents had always, all growing up, had always told us that was a possibility and to know that we had religious vocations, but it wasn't something they ever really pushed on us or talked about, I think in a large measure because they hadn't grown up with, I mean, more so with a priest, but they hadn't grown up with sisters, and all growing up, I never saw sisters. I mean, I was 17 before I saw a sister in a habit, so it wasn't something, I mean, to my vision, they were all off in India with Mother Teresa. It wasn't something I even knew about. But it was more as I grew older and started to get involved in the faith, a beginning realization of falling in love with God and wanting to give God everything, and then thinking, well, how do I do that? And the people in the parish began to say, I think you have a vocation. And I was like, what do you mean? What are you talking about? And the parish priest there actually paid for me to go out on a retreat and visit sisters. And I saw sisters who were young and my age and absolutely in love with God. And that was sort of the beginning of my realization, maybe this is for me. And in my first year of college, actually, I came out and visited my own community, the Dominican Sisters of Mary, Mother of the Eucharist. And when I met the sisters, I was so impressed by their joy and their fire and love for God. And I thought, that's what I want.
Is this a newer order of Dominican sisters?
Yes, it was founded in 97, and there were just four sisters when it was first founded. And since then, it's grown to, we're 47 now, and
wow,
there's a good
really?
15, 20 or so who are
Whoa.
Entering in August. So we're
in less than 10 years.
Yes, and we're building
Praise
and desperately
God.
In need of money because we have more sisters than
wow.
room to put them. So wow. it's a beautiful problem.
If the listeners want to find out more about your sisters, how could
yes.
they do that?
Well, we have an internet right. website at sistersofmary.org.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be one way.
Great.
And
you're in Ann Arbor,
yes,
Michigan?
Yes, in Ann Arbor, Michigan.
All right. Let's take a break. We'll come back just a moment. Let me give you that website again in case you are interested. Sisters of Mary, one word,
yes.
.org. And you can find out more about this very young order, but growing leaps and bounds by the blessings of God. So that's great. Thank you for sharing that about your parents and also yourself. Let's take a break. We'll be back just a moment with your questions for Sister. Let's see that. Welcome back. Our guest tonight is Sister Teresa Benedicta Block, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm glad you told them where the Teresa Benedicta came from, right?
Mm-hmm.
And as I thought about that, yeah, what a great honor you've done to recognize both sides of the faith that was given to you. I mean, that's wonderful to appreciate that. But mm-hmm. there's something before we go to the phone calls and emails, I'd like to talk a bit about a wonderful book called Transformation in Christ. Dr. von Hildebrand's wonderful book, which my guess in many ways came out of his teaching.
Yes.
So your mother may have gotten a little bit of that when she was there anyway, pre-book form, but that book had a big part to play in your parents' conversion.
Right? Yes, it was one of my mom's, actually her favorite books that Dietrich had ever written. And so as she and my dad began seriously dating, she sent that book to my father. And my father, when he read it, it was a little bit above his head, he said at the time, but he recognized that a lot of the qualities that Dietrich was writing about were qualities that he admired and saw in my mom. And he wanted some way to let her know how much he really appreciated that gift she had given him. And the copy of the book she sent him was kind of tattered and she'd well read. And he took it to a bookbinder and had it rebound and sent it back to her. And he said he saw that as a symbol of their relationship, that there were so many parts in their own lives and amongst the two of them that was tattered and that needed repairing, and that with God's grace and help could be bound together. And so, you know, to this day my parents have that rebound book, and they'll say it's kind of that symbol of how their own lives have been transformed
yeah.
in Christ.
Yeah. And let me recommend to the audience the book Transformation in Christ by Dr. von Hildebrand is available in the religious catalog, EWTN religious catalog. So if you're interested in that book, it's deep, but it's a wonderful summary of how we are to be new creatures in Christ as we surrender to Him. And it's a fine book. Let's go to our first caller. I think a familiar voice. Hello, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Hello, Dr. Alice von Hildebrand. It's great to hear from you. I was hoping you'd call.
Well, you can imagine that my joy at seeing Sister Benedicta on the screen. You know that I have 19 or 20 godchildren, and Stephanie and Stephen have given me such joy that I just have to tell you how grateful I am that I met them.
Dr. Von Hildebrand, could you do something for me quickly? Turn your TV down a little bit. We're hearing an echo from your voice. I want to make sure we hear you.
Is it better now?
Yes, yes, okay.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, the couple of things that I would like to add. As soon as Stephanie got married and my husband died, and then the next semester she dragged Steve into my classroom. And so he was taking my course on metaphysics. And very soon she was raging. She said to me, you know, I'm expecting a baby. And I said to her, when? And she said, in October. And I said, you know, your godfather was born in October. Try to deliver the baby on the 12th, on Columbus Day. And we can celebrate his birthday and the birthday of your little boy. And then 2 days before, Steve called me and she said, Stephanie apologized as he came 2 days too early. And then I spoke to Stephanie. She had just delivered the baby and was so happy, and I said to her, when is that baby going to be baptized? Because I was a bit concerned, because of course Steve was not in the church. And she said, oh, probably at about Christmas time. And I prayed, I was a little bit concerned. And then 2 or 3 days before Christmas, Steve calls me and said, the baby is going to be baptized on the 23rd, and it was in the Bronx. And I said, of course I've come. And I got stuck, there was an accident on the highway, and I was stuck for 1 full hour. And when I came to the church, they were coming out. And of course, I was very distressed, and I said to Steve, you realize what a baptism means in Catholic life? And she said, yes, and I insisted, and I said, you know, it's such an overwhelming experience, so realize that now the Holy Trinity is present in your little child's soul. And then he said, when I drive you back, I take you back to your car. And I repeated, I'm so sorry, I missed it. He said, don't you worry, there'll be another baptism soon. I said, what do you mean? He said, when I would like to enter the church, would you be my godmother? So that was one of the great days of my life. And I had the joy of being in Ann Arbor with my dear sister, Teresa Benedicta, 5 years ago. And we spent 2 lovely weeks together. And I just tell you the joy to see you once again. God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Von Hildebrand, for calling. Appreciate that. You know, those of you in the audience who've seen Dr. Alice Von Hildebrand on television, I hope you've appreciated what her witness has always been. But here's an example right now as we're sitting here on this television. You're seeing the second generation result of the faithfulness of Dr. Dietrich and Alice Von Hildebrand and their great witness to us after all these years. And God bless you, Alice. Thank you very much for calling. Let's take this next caller also, Arela from Texas. Arela, what's your question?
Hello?
Yes, hello, what's your question?
I had a question for Sister Therese. How do you get, you know, like my dad to convert?
No, that's a real quick question. What do you
think? Well, I don't think you can. I think God has to work in the soul, and he has to say yes to God. I think all you can do is love your Father with all your heart and pray for him, go before the Blessed Sacrament and storm heaven and trust that God will provide the grace and he'll work in your dad if you just keep storming heaven and trust in Jesus.
You know, it is interesting when you think about your parents' conversion. It just reiterates the fact that God can use almost anything with grace. So on the one hand, it doesn't mean don't worry about planting the seeds. No, it doesn't mean that. But it still means that most conversion comes about by grace. And since prayer connects people with grace, then prayer is the most important thing we can do, next to love, of course. So, I mean, your parents, I mean, a Presbyterian doesn't believe in God. Right,
yes.
In a Jewish intellectual out at Stanford, you know, but they don't necessarily seem like great avenues, but you're a witness to how God can use and work through grace in their life. So it's encouragement to this girl that was calling. Let's take this first email. Dear sister, this comes from John in Fairbury, Illinois. I am curious to know why your mother is specifically chose the Catholic Church over returning to Presbyterianism? Was her decision apologetically based, aesthetically based, etc.? Great show. Thank you very much for your email, John.
You know, I'm not sure I can 100% answer that, but from what I remember my mom talking about, it was kind of both. I think it was dissatisfaction in what she saw in the Presbyterian Church, and granted, she didn't have exactly the yeah. best role models there, but even from her own reading, she saw holes in the thought of the church, and it was more finding her answers in the Catholic faith and finding the witnesses of authentic Christian life in the Catholic faith. And so it was both intellectually and apologetically, and I suppose you could say aesthetically as well. It was all of them put together. But more concrete or in depth than that, I can't yeah. say.
Yeah, well, right, and in your mother's unique situation as a Presbyterian, which, like I said, is not typical of Presbyterianism by any means. But yet, I can imagine how it would be if you're discovering a God, you go back to a church that was willing to ordain you as a minister and say it isn't necessary for you to believe in God and mm-hmm. be a minister in that. It seemed to me that would be discouraging.
Yes.
To trust that, do they have the truth? If they can do that, as opposed to going to a church that has for 2,000 years emphasized the necessity of believing God, of course, even though sometimes some of our priests and bishops in history's past weren't formed very well, but they didn't mm-hmm. compromise the foundation. It was true to say, that's not important. You can still be, that mm-hmm. that would be discouraging for her. Let's take our next caller, Matthew from Virginia. Hello, Matthew. What's your question?
Hi. How are you, Marcus?
Fine.
I'm a convert to the church.
Hey, welcome home.
I came home. I'm so thankful.
Great.
My question is this. Is there a danger for Catholics to study philosophy, specifically existentialism, especially Christian existentialism, writers such as Camus and Kierkegaard? Is there a danger in studying this, and can it lead us off the path?
Thank you. All right. Thanks, Matthew.
I think it depends like everything, but also how are you studying it? Do you have teachers that you can trust to help you with your own questions? I think if you're studying it on your own and you're realizing I'm not getting it, then sure, there could be a danger in reading philosophers yeah. who don't agree with the church. But I think wherever there is a search for truth, as long as it's truth, it's going to lead you to God. And so if you're searching with the right way, and if you have people you can trust who will help you with those questions, yeah. where the truth is, it's only going to lead you closer to God.
And again, it emphasizes the need to trust authorities that you can
yes.
trust. You know, just to randomly grab a philosopher and read them without guidance in what you're reading, you can end up in the wrong way. But if Dr. Van Hildebrand was still on here, I know she would have said, no, Kierkegaard's a good thing. She loves mm-hmm. Kierkegaard. And is a strong proponent of the fact that Kierkegaard was always writing as a Christian. And the beauty of Kierkegaard was he was trying to awaken the Danish Christians who'd become so not just nominal, but it was destructive in their culture. And Kierkegaard was trying in his very unique way to bring them back to faith. And if you understand Kierkegaard as always writing as a Christian, read some of his more Christian, obviously Christian writings, then you'll be drawn to see that this is a good way of approaching it. But yet, I would also recommend there are a number of good books, one of which Rhonda Shervin has a good book on the love of wisdom, a number of other wonderful kind of overviews of philosophy that can help make sure you're reading it correctly and not being drawn away on kind of spurious ideas that some of the philosophers are throwing out there like bait for those that want to pull them away from the fullness. Let's go with this email from Brazil. Sonia is writing. She says, begins with, Dear Dr. Grodi, I'm just Mr. I used to be Reverend, but now I'm just an old football player trying to keep from looking like a football. That's the way I describe myself. I am writing from Brazil, and I am a very faithful viewer of Journey Home. I know some people who are Catholic, but they are Presbyterians now. I've tried to present all the rational arguments to show them how unreasonable it is to leave home. With so much division amongst the different Christian denominations, how can we know what is right? Well, their answer to that is, I know I accept Jesus, so I am going to be saved. They seem to be deaf to this line of thought. Can Sister Teresa help me with any other reasoning? Thank you, Sonia, for your email.
I think, you know, one of the things that my mom told my dad as he was searching for the truth is that you have to recognize that when you're entering into the faith, you're entering into a relationship. And if you enter into that relationship defensive or trying to attack, you're never going to fall in love. And one of the things when you're trying to spread the faith is you've got to be able to show people the beauty of it and for them to be willing to open themselves to fall in love and to let down their guards for a moment and see where is the truth. And I think if they're truly willing to search and if we truly have the truth, then it'll make itself known eventually. And I don't know, maybe you have some better from your own experience to add to that.
Well, my problem is I get going on that question. It's a great question. They're being drawn from the Catholic Church. They've left the Catholic Church for the Presbyterian Church. Why not go back? I give 1,000 reasons why. That's what our whole program is about. I think the number one question is the bottom line of authority on the things that they now believe. Where do you get those from? You know, you mentioned the divisions of Christianity, the thousands of different denominations that are out there. Well, what's wrong with this picture? The Bible obviously alone isn't sufficient because of the confusion that can come out of the Bible alone mentality. So how does one determine what's true of the Bible alone? So now you got to seek out, well, did Christ give us an authority we can trust? And that's why, as you just said, is this openness to the church. Don't come in with the kind of a set anger against things. Be open to what God can do in your heart and see the beauty of the church and the way things have come together, the way the Spirit has guided things together in the church. Let's take our next caller, Adele from Illinois. Hello, what's your question?
Yes, a beautiful show, beautiful love story.
Yes, 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 yes.
And my question is, what was your grandparents' reaction on your mother's side? You had mentioned kind of your father's family, how they reacted to the conversion. How about on your mother's side?
Very good. Thanks, Adele.
Well, it was kind of twofold. Her father had actually died before she fully converted. And her mom saw her shift from this very depressed person to suddenly full of life and joy. And so I think her mom was much more accepting of it simply because she saw that change in her. And then she soon died thereafter as well, actually before my mom had even married my dad, although she knew it was coming. So I think her mom's perspective was simply, well, at least she's not depressed anymore. At least she has joy. And so she was accepting of it from that standpoint.
Now, on your father's side, you said they don't talk about the Catholic faith very much.
Right.
But then you show up at family gatherings.
You know, it's a very strange situation because they know all of us are Catholic, and obviously I'm a sister, and I have a younger brother who just entered the seminary this year. So it's very obvious that, you know, we're a Catholic family, and we've never hidden that. And I think my grandparents over the years, I mean, they absolutely love us, and no one was prouder than my grandparents when they heard that I was, you know, entering the convent. But as for my dad, because if it was officially known, they would have to make the choice, do we sit Shiva for him? Do we sit the service for the dead and disown him? Mm-hmm. It was easier for them to say, and they've told him outright, don't tell us. They know, but they don't want to know. You know, it's one of those funny situations where it's not discussed. So it's known, it's obvious we're all Catholic. It's obvious my dad goes to Mass with us and has done it. But it's one of those things we don't talk about in the family.
Yeah, interesting.
At least from my dad's perspective, obviously us kids do all the time.
Yeah. Next caller, Justin from Wisconsin. Hello, Justin. What's your question?
Good evening, family.
Yeah.
I'm just calling. I'm curious, coming from myself as a convert as well, how apostolic succession and especially Petrine primacy affected, especially your father's conversion, if that had much of a role in his connect from Judaism into Catholicism.
Great, Justin. Thank you very much.
I think yes and no. I feel like I say that all this whole time. A lot of it was seeing holes in Judaic thought. For instance, he often talked about eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, and in the Moses law, and wondering, how do you answer that? Hmm. Or where is the Savior that's been promised? And so it was more coming to accept Christ as the Savior and seeing that Christ answered those questions, that Christ was able to talk about forgiving one's enemies, that Christ was able to be the Savior. And it was once he accepted Christ, it was easy for him to say, well, if Jesus is Lord and God, then what Jesus teaches, the apostles that he set up, the church that he set up, must be true. But it was more getting to that point of first accepting Jesus as the Messiah. And once he could do that, everything else was relatively easy. Although he also said Mary was a big obstacle for him, as it is for many converts. And when he actually converted, he had to realize that, how do you put it, that he had to accept that there were some things he couldn't understand, and that Mary's role was one of them. But he knew the Catholic faith was true, and so he was willing to accept that he didn't quite understand her position, which is funny because, you know, today he said, like, she's played a more important role in his life than, you know, any other saint, and she's done such wonders and beauty for his life. And my dad prays the rosary every day, and he said he always feels ashamed that she was the last part of the faith that he was ever able to accept.
It is so true for so many converts. Even, again, interesting, whether from Presbyterianism or Judaism, Mary is such a big hurdle for them all.
Yes.
So she ends up on the nice shelf for a while, you know, before you're able to take her down and really think about her, and then often becomes so strong in their lives. Let's go to Shannon from Illinois. Hello, Shannon. What's your question or comment?
Hello, sister.
Yes.
I'm calling mostly because I was excited this evening. I watched the rerun of the Mass this morning, and I saw all of you sisters in the chapel there, and I saw that you were Dominicans, and I was just real curious where you were from. So I just wanted to tell you that I'm a revert. I've been back almost 4 years.
Welcome.
I was an evangelical Protestant, and I was taught for 12 years by loving Dominican sisters from Grand Rapids, Michigan. And they gave me such a foundation in my faith that I never lost, and I was always deeply Catholic even when I was an evangelical. But I'm calling just to tell you that when I look now and I see young people like yourself giving your whole life to Christ, I have such hope for the Catholic Church, and I have come back into, I am part of something so huge that the Holy Spirit is doing. It is such an honor, and I'm humbled. And I'm just thrilled to see you, and I will pray for you.
I'm just excited
for you, and I'm grateful to God as a Catholic to have someone like you and other women and men like you.
Thank you, Shannon, very much.
Gosh,
God bless you.
What can you add to that? You know, it's so beautiful.
That was wonderful. It made me think that during this wonderful time, when as she says, she sees so many fine young men and women who are going into religious life as great hope for the Church, and I'm wondering, with the formation of your order, what part did John Paul II play in that?
Gosh, he was the reason we were even founded. In 1996, he wrote the encyclical Vita Consecrata on religious life. And one of the things that he asked for was that those communities that were solid started sending out sisters or brothers to bring back religious life. And our founder says, realized that was, you know, the Holy Spirit speaking to them, and they had been given everything and they need to go out and spread it. And so they came up to Michigan, the four of them, to found this new community directly in answer to the Holy Father's call to bring back religious life throughout the world and to spread the new evangelization. So it was very much a part of him. And all of us, you know, as young sisters, it's funny, many of us were at World Youth Days, and the Holy Father played such an important role in our own coming into the Church.
Yeah. So were you there in Denver?
I wasn't there in Denver, no, but I'm one of those ones who was, you know, he was Pope my entire life.
Yeah, that's right.
So.
That's right. Well, let's take another break, and we'll come back for some final thoughts for the journey home. See you in a bit. We've been talking about, with your questions on phone calls and emails, as well as listening to Sister Teresa talk about her parents' journey of faith. You know, I was thinking about your name, Sister Teresa Benedicta, which honors a woman whose conversion was in a very difficult time in our world's history, but was willing to follow and love Jesus no matter what it costs. And your religious sister, committed to loving and serving our Lord Jesus. Talk to the audience maybe as a way of concluding from your experience now as in your religious life and in your studies. What does it mean? What does it truly mean to love and serve Jesus?
It's a great question. I think the key lies in love. What does it mean to really love Jesus? And to me, the best answer is look at Jesus' life. How did he live his life? How did he give himself away every single day to the people he came in contact, to the moment of his ultimate gift of self on the cross? And if we're really going to love him, we have to love like him and recognize that we're entering into a relationship of love where we are united with Christ, and that means we have to give ourselves the way Jesus gave himself. And we give ourselves day by day and all those ordinary little tasks of the day that you know, you often don't think about, but they have great significance in the way we treat each other, the way we treat other people, the way you respond to all those occasions in our life show whether or not we're followers of Jesus. And it's that not just imitation of Christ, but living in union with him at every single moment that shows how we really love and serve him. And I think that's a key Catholic thought, that it's not, we're not just imitating Christ, but we're immersed in him. And that's the beauty of the Eucharist, where Christ is really, really present, and that we're getting to live that and to experience. It's like the image of a mother with a child in her womb. We're in the womb of the Church, and we're living that life united to Christ. And that's what it means to fall in love, is to recognize at every moment I'm united with him, and that every single person I come into contact with is united with Jesus, and that they show forth an aspect and a character of God that no other person can.
Your first name, Sister Teresa, is that to Saint Teresa or Saint Therese?
It's actually to Edith Stein.
Edith Stein, right. But I think she got it from Saint Therese.
Yes, it was from...
So the connection there, I think one of the most things I want to remind even my own sons is one of the beauties of St. Therese, as connected with what you've said, is being faithful in little things. Mm-hmm. We always want to focus on the big things, but it's really in the faithfulness in the little things in which we can truly let Christ flow through us, recognizing the beauty of what the little things can bring about in the faith of others and ourselves. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
What a great pleasure it is. And thank you for joining us on Journey Home. It's always a pleasure. See you again next week. God bless. Mm-hmm.